If the Roskill Commissioner's report is accepted and London's third airport is sited at Cudlington, this village, the village of Stewkley in Buckinghamshire, will be wiped out, razed to the ground and filled with concrete. For the villagers, the airport will be the end of a life pattern which can't be resurrected. None of us care very much about planning, so long as it doesn't interfere with us. But this bit of planning that may finish off this village and two others and make life unbearable in another three is an outsized piece of planning. It's possibly the biggest interference with ordinary human existence that's ever been planned in this country. Well, you may say it only affects 7,000 people, and it isn't a very pretty village anyway. Why should they be privileged? There are several answers to that.
This is a way of life. It's a very ancient one. The families here in Stewkley have been here mostly 5 or 6 centuries, and they can look after themselves and each other. They don't have to have Meals on Wheels and social workers. Everything works as if the family were able to look after the whole thing here in Stewkley and at the other villages.
We're not upper-class people, we're not middle-class people, we're not lower-class people, we're first-class people. Come on, now, come on.
Well, of course, we're all first-class people, but not all of us are like these people who see themselves as first-class by virtue of their sense of community, their relationships inside a working group. If the new airport comes here, it wouldn't be anything like this strip which the countryside has been able to assimilate. The new airport will occupy a space of 5 miles by 2.5. And many a devoted life plan, seen in terms not of years but of generations, will be suddenly meaningless. This man has spent 22 years making a field where an airstrip used to be. What for? There's no big business in this sort of community. In terms of pounds and pence, it's mere peanuts. People here don't live the pillar-to-post lives of people in the cities. They want something better, and in their view, they've achieved it. You could say that here in Buckinghamshire, they've solved that nagging problem of urban man, how to be human in the technological society. They've come to a working arrangement with each other, and that is their life.
Oh, I don't really know where we should go. My mother's a middle-aged woman, and, well, I wouldn't want her to be miles and miles away from us. I should want her to be somewhere where we are. And I don't really know what we should do, where we should go.
I don't know what I should do with mine, because my mother's 83, she's blind now. Where we should put them, we don't know. My father's 86, and I don't want them away from me.
And I've also got an old mother, 82, and a brother that's single. Well, they'd have to be moved, and I don't know where they'd go. And if we weren't near them, well, I think it'd just be the end of my mother altogether, you know.
So the questions which have to be asked before these people's lives disappear under the concrete are something like this. Does some quality rub off onto people from work well and slowly done with pride in it? Are they really better off as they think they are? Not working in large factories against the clock. The man who owns this workshop finds it difficult to define the characteristics of his village, Bill Grace.
It's rather a job to analyse Stewkley people, if you want them broken down into analysis. I think it'd take a far better commission than Roskill, for instance, to start on them. People of integrity, they are, of course. This will be proved by any of the merchants in the surrounding towns. Go to any of the banks. No dissenters much in here. They're dealt with internally, if they are. We've never had anyone flywheel here, as they call it, much.
Bill Grace's family has been here a very long time. His son traces his name back in the local records for 5 centuries. Even quite ordinary families in these parts of Buckinghamshire are proud of a long line of ancestors. It doesn't have to be a famous historical family like the Verneys.
Well, this is Van Dyck's portrait of Sir Edmund Verney, which was given to him by his king, Charles I, for whom he was Knight Marshal. And he raised the king's standard at Nottingham at the beginning of the Civil War and carried it into Edge Hill, where he was killed. He was carrying the king's standard, and he was surrounded by roundheads who demanded that it should be surrendered. Sir Edmund refused, so they killed him. And in death, of course, his hand closed on the standard and couldn't be wrenched out. So they cut off his hand at the wrist, and later on in the battle, the standard was recaptured by the royalists with his wrist still on it. And we've got the ring which he was wearing on his finger that day. The hand was brought home and buried here in Middle Claydon Church. The body was never found, so our family ghost is Sir Edmund walking about looking for his hand. Buckinghamshire has always produced people to fight against tyranny. John Hampden was a fellow member of the Long Parliament of Sir Edmund's, fought against ship money. John Milton against the tyranny of arbitrary government. Wilkes against rigging elections. Edmund Burke was a Buckinghamshire man. And today we're fighting against a new tyranny, the tyranny of technology, as represented by the Roskell Report. And we're determined that that's not going to win.
They say no, and they'll need to say it in a very loud voice. They say that aircraft would miss the church tower at Whitchurch by only about 12 feet. It would be right at the end of the runway. In this quiet street, the level of noise is about 50 decibels. The takeoff of a jet aircraft produces 60 times as much noise as that. It's an experience like listening to a pop group at a range of 4 feet or a train whistle at 50. In a word, it's murder. Noise of this kind has a noticeable effect on patients in hospital and children at school. The people concerned with education in the area of Heathrow have reported that children are unable to concentrate and lag behind the school's average. In this school, noise will be no problem. This school will disappear.
There is such lovely countryside around here, and the most honest and respectable people.
I like Stewkley because you can play in the fields and run about in fresh air. I lived in Luton and then I moved to Bristol, and from there I came here to live.
I was born in Watford. I lived there for 8 years. I like Stewkley better than Watford. Stewkley is somehow different.
Suppose these children are dispersed into larger schools in an urban area. Does it matter? The headmaster thinks that it does.
They don't get the competition that they might get in a larger town school. Whether this is a good thing or not, again, is a debatable point. I think they're much more relaxed in the country. They have, a better attitude towards adults, towards each other, than possibly town children. I think this is... I ought to be careful here. I'm only speaking from my own personal experience, but we do sometimes get children from town schools who have to be socially re-educated to fit in, you know, with our rather gentle, relaxed ways, I suppose.
Sid Hounslow, who comes from Drayton Parslow, has his problems, which are typical. Both he and his wife have aged parents. She looks after her mother and father. He looks after his at the weekends. And his sister bicycles over from Stewkley to cook and clean for them every day. In this part of the country, if you wish to be regarded as a fully paid-up member of the human race, you shoulder all your responsibilities and give a hand with other people's.
Cold? Ooh, it's cold.
It's freezing now, do you reckon, right?
My hands are dreadful cold.
The word social never crops up in ordinary conversation. There's no need for it. This, inevitably, is how decent people behave.
Yeah, do every night, really.
In a closely knit society like this one, the mental disturbance which dispersal would bring is almost unimaginable to an urban or suburban family. In this village, 202 people out of a population of 382 are interrelated by blood or by marriage. Isabel Smith Cresswell.
It would cause almost total disruption because it is perhaps possible for two households to arrange to move together, but with many of these, there will be perhaps 5 to 7 households, not all in this village, some of them in neighbouring villages, who would have to move in concert if the family were to be kept intact. I mean, this happens with this group here, it happens with this group here, it happens with this group, where there are still 8 children living in the village from one, and they all call regularly on one another, sisters calling on one another, helping one another. In the normal way, it's friendly, but when the crisis occurs, they're ready to meet it.
The long-drawn-out threat hanging over the whole area brings all enterprise to a stop. Lionel House is building up a small, highly intensive farm. He has 63 cows on 63 acres. It's very hard work in which not only his money, but his life is invested. It entails constant money decisions, whether to build new cow houses now or later. While the threat looms overhead, there's no point in doing anything.
You get very depressed at present moment, I'm afraid, with probably the weather as well doesn't help. But as regards this airport, it's very depressing. It's been going on too long as far as a person who's sitting in the area is concerned, and it affects you. You can't... I can't say with words how it affects you, but it does badly affect you. When I feel in the mood to work, which many people do when they're young, it's bad to be held back like this, I feel. In another 2 or 3 years, I might be getting over the top, you know. I just want to work and get the farm going as well, but it might not be there to do this, you know. When you come into a small holding, you have to do everything yourself, you can't afford labour, and it takes it out of you tremendous. Until people have been in it and know about it and have to do all the work, every bit of work on their own, they just don't know.
And you don't have to be in agriculture to suffer from planner's blight. David Stubbs is a freelance designer who works at home, and his wife commutes to London every day. But their pride and joy in their country cottage has been sadly diminished since the blow fell.
It's cost us a lot of money, and friends and relations that we've used to see regularly, we simply haven't seen for 2 years, and they don't really understand. We haven't been able to look ahead at all as to what sort of future we're going to have.
That's quite true. I mean, people have, you know, after we were married, they were interested in where we were living and they wanted to come here. And we never got round to asking them, and then, of course, we were hit by this. And I don't think they understand now that it's so serious, you know. You see, although we've informed ourselves about the size of the thing and all the implications which would go with it, it's still, when you walk around here and drive around here, it's still almost impossible to imagine it all as a concrete, well, 4 concrete runways and everything that goes with an airport. You see, it'll be 3.5 times the size of Heathrow, and Heathrow's jolly big when you go there, and so is all the rest that goes with it, all the conurbation, all the towns.
The regional planning...
Buckinghamshire Council have no use for the airport either. The chief planner, Fred Pooley, puts these points forward.
The first is that the site of the moment is a beautiful green belt which really splits London from Birmingham. Now, if the airport comes to Cublington, not only will there be 300 miles of beautiful countryside under noise shadows, but there'll be the airport and another 250,000 people here. And that will give rise to a continuous wedge of development between London and Birmingham. Therefore, if you're in the west of the country, want to get to the east, you've really got to go all through this urbanisation, and that's a bad thing. Now, our second point is this. Here's Cublington again, wedged between Oxford and Luton and Bletchley. Now, this is an area of very high employment. At the moment, there are three jobs advertised for every unemployed, and the proposal to put the airport here would mean another 65,000 jobs wedged between the car industries of Oxford and Luton. Now, this must be, I would have thought, bad economics for the country and lead to inflation in this area. But if you go to Foulness here at Southend, the reverse is true. There are three unemployed for every job advertised, and Southend has a long connection with the East End of London, where there is obviously social inequality. So if you can put the airport here, 65,000 jobs, this must start to solve social problems. Now, our third point is this. If you put the airport at Cublington, you've got to drive at least two big new motorways through the Chiltern Hills. We've had experience of this. Only recently, the government have been trying to fix the line of the M40 motorway through a similar country, and it really gives rise to tremendous problems, and people get very, very fed up about it. But here again, if the airport goes to Foulness, it gives tremendous opportunity to drive brand new roads through this kind of development, through the East End of London. It could lead to renaissance equal to that in the middle of the last century when Napoleon redeveloped Paris. And our last point is simply this. Most people seem to believe that Foulness is off on a limb. Now, this is the Southeast England and London in the middle of it, and this is what the airlines describe as their honeypot. This is the area that gives rise to all their traffic, or the majority of their traffic. Now, it's purely a matter of fact that Foulness is more accessible by road to more people in here than Cublington.
The Roskill Commission's conclusions were all arrived at by cost-benefit analysis. They put a value on everything, but it was an economic value. According to this method, the value of a Norman church, say, is its insured value. The value of a large tree against the skyline is the cost of the wood in it. No other values could be assessed economically, and so that's the only ones they had anything to say about. Now, we may say that they couldn't really take into account the value, for instance, to Londoners of a big strip of green country to relax in. You can't relax with airplanes roaring in and out. Well, are there any other values? We may say that they're very difficult to assess, but we all know that there are other values, and the case against the Roskill Commission is that those values, which they were unable to assess, in fact outweigh the values they were able to put into figures. In fact, there's evidence that we're all concerned with these other values. At Claydon House, the number of visitors has been increasing by 10% every year, and with good reason, Ralph Verney says.
They want somewhere where they can go for rational recreation, whether it's picnicking or games of various kinds, or just having a drive quietly in their car and sitting by the roadside reading the newspaper. I don't think there are nearly enough facilities. I think we've got to learn to understand this pressure. When I say we, I mean we who farm and forest the land. And this is a very difficult problem, because farmers are inclined to think that they know best, and they've got to learn that other people have needs as well. This is something we're trying gradually to come to terms with, but it's not a bit easy when you've been in your home for a very long time to realise that you've got to share it with somebody else. There are 8.5 million people living within 25 miles of the Chilterns, quite apart from those who come out from London. And those people all go there because it's quiet, because it's lovely, but also because it's quiet. And this is tremendously important to them.
A 10% a year increase of townspeople looking for peace and quiet. What is the point of having the National Trust acquire these great properties in our name if houses like Wadston Manor, which had 75,000 visitors last year, are to be made hideous by noise? There are no less than 5 National Trust properties under the proposed noise blight. The increased use of land for the recreation of the people of our densely packed southeast corner is beginning to worry the farmers. They're always sitting on committees to try to do something about it. But if the farmers have a problem with the flocks of tourists, the airport planners have another with the flocks of starlings. A local naturalist who gave evidence to the Roskill Commission about bird strike, the danger of crashing because birds clog the engine intake, was Victor Scott.
I know it's very difficult to compare Cuplington with Fowl Ness because we are at a very great disadvantage in that we don't have anything extremely rare. We don't have anything, for example, to compare with the dark-bellied Brent geese.
Brent geese get good publicity. In fact, a few Brent geese up the intake of a jet are no more fatal than a bunch of starlings.
There's a flock coming in over the top of Lyons Hill, right over there in the distance. You see them coming in at a height of about 150 to 200 feet. Noise of traffic doesn't disturb them, and they would very quickly become accustomed to noise of aircraft, such as they would get here. The only way in which they could be removed would, in fact, be by the cutting down of every suitable roosting site over a radius of 10 miles or more from the actual centre of the airport.
From a pilot's point of view, all he needs is an adequate length of concrete and sufficiently good landing aids to get him down. From a commercial point of view, it's obviously more desirable to have an aerodrome that's near to a centre, but I think this has far less significance now than it used to. British Railways are talking about advanced passenger service trains, which are capable of doing 150 miles an hour.
Don Bellingham is an ex-BOAC pilot, not convinced that the saving of the 5 minutes which Cuplington could knock off the journey to London compared with Fowl Ness is worth the blight on the countryside which it involves. He's biased because a runway would run right through the middle of his house.
Well, St Michael's is one of only 3 unspoilt parochial churches of the Norman period that have not been added to, or beautified, or made more magnificent in the Gothic era.
Professor Colin Buchanan, the only professional planner on the Roskill Commission, dissented from their precious document because he was not greatly impressed by cost-benefit analysis as a yardstick for measuring human needs. The human spirit, he contended, was better sustained by quite other considerations than a shilling or two off the train fare, important as that might be, and that a large and increasing number of people agreed with this view. It may seem a bit excessive for a community of 1,200 people to run 4 football teams, but Stewkley is like that. Their sense of community is dense and implacable. Whether we approve of this or not, it's high time the planner's blight of anxiety and insecurity was lifted from Buckinghamshire, and people could once again find fulfilment in their daily enterprises.
So it's near blasphemy for a commission of learned economists, however well-intentioned, to try to add up the benefits of living in Stewkley and weigh them against the price of an air ticket to New York. The beauty of the countryside, it can't be bought. And so this morning, give thanks to God, the giver of all that is good. Give thanks to him in a building that other men raised to his glory 800 years ago. A building which 20th century man can pay a contractor to demolish.
The people threatened by the Third London Airport are not relying on God for any special dispensation in their favour. They've taken up arms in a very businesslike way, and the Wing Airport Resistance Association has produced a very well-argued case in rebuttal of the Roskill Commission's conclusions. For instance, it points out that airport functions and transport of passengers make up almost 99% of the cost in cost-benefit terms. Are the community's interests worth only 1% then? What happens if the case goes against them? The chairman of the resistance movement, Desmond Fennell.
Wearer certainly doesn't become militant. Once the democratic decision has been made, then the possibility of any further action is really concluded. But there are inevitably a number of people who do feel burningly about this, and it's quite possible that they may resort to direct action. But the association could have nothing to do with that. But that's rather a pessimistic note. We're absolutely convinced that it's not going to come to that, and that sort of action would never be necessary.
Well, of course, the whole place is plastered over with signs like that. A piece of protest. We see such a lot of protest nowadays, we tend to discount it. But these people mean it. I think we have to take this seriously. At any rate, the special branch has been poking about down here because they take it seriously enough. There is a group here about which great tales are told. They say they have plans for blowing up the machines of destruction when they come to make the airport with high explosives and that sort of thing. Well, whether any of that is true or not, I don't know.
But what we all know is that their case is the crux of the matter between the people of England and the technological society. It matters very greatly for the future of this island who wins this fight.